the Bhagavad Gita. This is something which is well known to most people. Very few might have not heard the name the Bhagavad Gita. And it is almost universally accepted as a scripture, not merely in a sense of holiness or sanctity from the point of view of a religious outlook, but it has been regarded as a guide in our day-to-day life, which need not necessarily mean a so-called religious attitude. Our life is vaster in its expanse than what we usually regard as a vocation of religion. And if religion is an aspect of our life and does not constitute the whole of our life, the Bhagavad Gita is not a religious scripture. Because its intention is not to cater to a side of your nature or a part of your expectations in life, but the whole of what you need and what you are. This special feature in the Bhagavad Gita makes it a little difficult for people to comprehend its significance and message. While hundreds of expositions are there on this great gospel, and several commentaries have been written and are being written even now, it is difficult to believe that its meaning has been completely grasped, and it becomes novelty after novelty as we go deeper and deeper. The more you read it, the fresher it appears before our eyes, like the sun, rise of the sun every day. It never looks hackneyed or old. It has a vigor, a vitality and freshness. As I mentioned, comparable to the sunrise every day, which appears every day fresh and vigorous and delightful. This especiality and the comprehensiveness, which is the approach of the Gita, is what makes it a little distinct from the other well-known religious guidelines. You have heard it often said that it is an episode in a large epic of India known as the Mahabharata, and we regard it as a teaching given by someone to someone in some ancient times in a particular context of those ancient days. We are likely to read this epic as a story, like a drama or a play, for our diversion and emotional satisfaction. But this large epic of which the Bhagavad Gita is an episode is not a story of a grandmother told to a child though it is narrated in the fashion of a dramatic story with images and artistic touches of characters which portray various facets of human thinking and attitude. What inspires us and stirs us when we read an epic of this kind is the sympathy that exists between these characters and the various phases of our own personal lives. We find ourselves somehow or other in these characters. We are drawn to these characters on account of they being symbolic representations, as it were, of what we ourselves are at different moods or times or layers of our own personality. All these people, the heroes and heroines, the dramatic personae of the Mahabharata, are present inside us, and we ourselves are these at different occasions and times. We have layers and layers of personality in us, and these various layers correspond to the ideal images that are portrayed in the characters of this great epic, the Mahabharata. Why are you inspired when you read a play of Shakespeare? Because you are present there. Every one of these wondrous characters that Shakespeare, for instance, delineates with his masterly stroke of a pen corresponds to our own selves in some manner or the other. Every character of Shakespeare is present in us, and we are every one of these. So we are in sympathy with these, we are in rapport with all these characters, and we are stimulated by a study or reading of this place. It is human nature as such that is displayed in these dramas of Shakespeare or the epics of Homer or the epic of the Mahabharata, for instance. It is not a story of some people that lived sometime, but it is a story of all people that may live at any time in the history of the universe. Again, to come to this point of Shakespeare, they are not stories of some people. They are stories of people as such, of any person. And the nomenclature of these personalities is only by the way. And the essentiality is the attitude, the character, the conduct, and the personal and social features that they demonstrate in their temporal existence. The characters are perpetual features in the evolution of the cosmos, while the vehicles which embody or enshrine these characters may vary. These are the specific stages through which the world has to pass. And as every individual is a part of the world, everyone has to pass through every one of these stages. So every character is every person and vice versa. Thus, while the epic of the Mahabharata, like some other epics also of the world, of this nature, attempts to portray the culture of an entire nation, or we may say the culture of humanity in general, it pinpoints its teaching at a central occasion which it regards as the most convenient hour to give its message in its essentiality. The Bhagavad Gita is the kernel of this vast expanded fruit of the Mahabharata, which has grown out of the tree of the culture of India. The philosophic messages which are given in the various chapters of the Gita are dramatically portrayed in the characters of the story or the epic of the Mahabharata. So the one explains the other. The narrative of the Mahabharata, the epic aspect of this great work, is a performance in the stage of humanity of the message that is to be conveyed in the form of the Bhagavad Gita. And when we look at it the other way around, the Bhagavad Gita is what is intended behind the whole narration of the Mahabharata. So the great author of this epic achieves a double stroke by this masterpiece that he has given to mankind. He gives directly a message that has to go into our souls, and at the same time makes it appealing to the various psychological features which constitute our personality. And as I mentioned a little earlier, its message is not religious in the common sense meaning of the term. It does not teach any religion. If by religion you mean the so-called faiths of the world that are prevalent today, such as Hinduism, Buddhism, Christianity, Islam and what not. It does not teach any of these religions. Though, under a misapprehension, we may imagine that it is a Hindu scripture. It is a scripture that has originated in India, maybe by an accident in the history of the universe. But it is not meant only for the people of India. It is meant for people and all people. And all people for all times, not only for some time. It is therefore not a message that Krishna gave to Arjuna, and therefore we can just set it aside as something relevant to those times and not applicable to these days. It is a message of eternity, and therefore it is a timeless significance for every one of us. It does not get rusted or worn out by the movement of time or the changes that takes place geographically, socially or politically. The vicissitudes of life have no impact upon this message, because it arises from a source which has transcended the vicissitudes of life. And in a few words which occur towards the end of each chapter as a colophon of these chapters, we are given an indication of its eternality of character. It is supposed to be a message which embodies the knowledge of what is ultimately real and not merely temporarily valuable or significant. When everything passes away, something shall remain. And what that something is the object of the quest of this knowledge which is embodied in the Bhagavad Gita. Therefore it is called Brahma Vidya, the knowledge of the Absolute, Brahman. The reality that cannot further be transcended is called the Absolute. It is so called because it is not related to anything else. Therefore, it is non-relative being. I am related to you, you are related to me. Therefore, our existence is relative. One thing hangs on the other. But the Absolute does not hang on something else for its description, characterization or existence. In our case, or in the case of anything for the matter of that, existence is conditioned by other existences. For instance, we are depending on various factors for our life in this world. We require sunlight, we require water, we require air, we require food, we require social cooperation and protection and many other things of this nature. So that if these external conditioning features are absent, our personal individual existence may be wiped out in a few days. So we have no independent status of our own. We depend on other factors for our existence, and other things also depend on us in a similar manner. There is a mutual dependence of characters, individuals and things in this world. Therefore we say the whole world is relative. It has no absolute reality. But this relativity of things in the world is a pointer to the possibility of the existence of something which is not relative. The idea of relativity cannot arise unless there is something which makes us feel that things are relative. That which enables you to be conscious of the relativity of things cannot itself be relative. So there is a necessity to admit the existence of that which is not relative, that is designated in scriptures like the Upanishads, etc., as Brahman, the Absolute Being. It is a nomenclature, a name that we give for purpose of our own descriptive understanding to that which must exist as transcendent to anything that you see with your eyes, or anything that you can conceive with your mind. It is therefore the knowledge of the Absolute, Brahma Vidya. This is mentioned at the end of each chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Upanishadsu Brahma Vidyayam. It is also called an Upanishad, something very strange. It is an esoteric teaching, plumbing the depths of the essentiality of things behind the veneer of encrustations in the shape of names and forms. An Upanishad is a secret teaching. It is secret because it has concern with that which cannot be seen with the eyes. It is not related to appearances. The names and the forms of the world are not the subject of the Upanishad. Its relationship is that which is behind the names and forms. As its connection is with that which the senses cannot perceive and perhaps the mind also cannot think adequately, it is to an extent regarded as secret, and therefore it is not an exoteric teaching, it is an esoteric message. Therefore it is Upanishad. And the Upanishad being such, the Bhagavad Gita, which is regarded as the quintessence of the teaching of the Upanishads, is also regarded as an Upanishad. And interestingly, before us, it is mentioned in plural, Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Su Upanishadsu. It does not say Upanishadi. It is not one Upanishad. It appears to be many Upanishads, brought together in a force of concentration. Whereas each chapter is an Upanishad by itself. Each chapter is a message by its own status. Well, there have been people who thought that even a single verse can be regarded as a message. One verse is sufficient, not the whole chapter. Great devotees of the Bhagavad Gita have received inspiration from even a single verse. You open any page of the Bhagavad Gita, you will find there something which will inspire you at once and lift you up from the turmoils of the ordinary life that you live in the world. So, it is a plurality of Upanishads and not one Upanishad merely. All the Upanishads are here condensed in their quintessential, supra-essential essence. So, Bhagavad Gita-su, Gita-su, plural again. The songs, not merely the song. The songs of the Lord. Many messages are conveyed through the various chapters and the various verses, so that every disease conceivable of human nature can be remedied by some medicine or the other that is there in the form of some word of the Bhagavad Gita. It is a medicine for every illness of life, not merely my illness or your illness or this illness or that illness. It is also considered as an essence of all the scriptures. Many times it is said, Sarva Shastra Mayi Gita. All the Shastras, all the lessons that you can have anywhere, at any time, can be found here in some way or the other. So it is an esoteric, secret teaching concerning the reality behind things. And it does not cater merely to a sentiment that is attached to appearances. It is intended to do you good in the ultimate sense of the term, and not merely to cater to your imagination or a temporary emotional ebullition. It is not merely an academic or theoretical message or gospel concerning the nature of the Absolute or Brahman. It is at the same time, and this is its special character, it is at the same time a practical guidelight for the purpose of treading the path to the realization of this ultimate reality. It is therefore a Yoga Shastra, not merely a Brahma Vidya. You will find very few texts which combine these two aspects of teaching. It is not an emphasis that is laid only on one side of your life, but on all sides equally balanced. So it is a theory and a practice. And practice is preceded by theory. The comprehension of the techniques to be employed in any particular line of action is called theory. And when the theory is grasped, you know how to implement it in your daily life. That implementation is practice. So here you have Brahma Vidya and Yoga Shastra, the science of the Absolute and the practical teaching on Yoga, which is the art of coming in contact with Brahman, the Absolute, which is propounded in its gospel. And it is something more wonderful and more incapable of ordinary imagination than what we have already said. It is a conversation between God and man, which meaning is conveyed by the phrase Krishna Arjuna Samvada. Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Upanishadsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastri Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvade. Krishna and Arjuna are taken as occasions for bringing into highlight the relationship that exists between the absolute and the relative. The epic has a special artistic character of its own. That is the beauty of a drama, and you enjoy it, though the enjoyment part of it has behind it a teaching or a moral or a lesson to be conveyed. So, as I mentioned, the characters of the Mahabharata are present perpetually in the features of the human being, and so are the characters Krishna and Arjuna. They are eternal realities and not persons merely that might have lived historically sometime many, many years back. It is not merely a temporal history that is recounted to us in the epic. It is a story of the eternal drama that is played in the cosmos. And meaningful, therefore, for all times, under every circumstance, to every person. As the message is imparted to the eternal individual by the eternal reality, this teaching is also eternal. There is some essence in you which is perpetual in its nature. And that permanent essential feature in you is the individuality of yours, which has a permanent relationship with the Supreme Being. It is therefore not a message conveyed in mere temporal language to suit merely a tentative occasion or a given moment of time, but this specific occasion of the Mahabharata was taken as a necessary context by the author of the Mahabharata to convey to the eternal human nature its relationship with the eternal absolute. The union of the individual with the absolute is the final consummation of this story. The setting in tune of Arjuna with Krishna is the setting in tune of yourself with the all being, which is Brahman, the absolute. So the story of the universe, which is also the story of any country or nation, which is also the story of your own self, is therefore a story of the movement of all creation to the Creator, the Father of all things that are here as phenomena. The world moves towards God, and this is the story of creation. This is what you call evolution. This is what you call desire. This is what you call aspiration. This is need. This is requirement. This is necessity, this is hunger, this is thirst, and this is everything that is blessed here. all your requirements, whatever be their nature, are necessitated by the particular feature of the context of evolution at any given moment of time in which you are involved and in which everyone is involved. So you can imagine, with this little introduction I have placed before you, the widespread comprehensiveness of the gospel, of the teaching of the Bhagavad Gita. It leaves nothing unsaid. And the language in which this message is conveyed has behind it hiddenly an incomprehensible secret. And the deeper you go within yourself, the deeper is the meaning that you will discover in it. If your outer personality reads the Gita, you will see only the outer feature of its message. If you study it as a linguist, a Sanskritist, or an academician, you will see only that aspect of it there. If you read it as a journalist or a novelist, you will see only a beautiful story narrated, which only appeals to your feelings and emotions. If you read it as a psychologist, you will find an unraveling of the mysteries of the human psyche there. If you read it as a rationalist, you will find there are tremendous arguments for substantiating the various verities of the cosmos. And if you read it as a seeker, you will find there a parent to take care of you, a father and a mother, which will console you and solace you under moments of despair when clouds hang heavily in the horizon and you cannot visualize the light of the sun. So such is the tremendous depth of this well-known gospel and teaching known as the Bhagavad Gita. The epic of the Mahabharata, in which this Bhagavad Gita occurs, of which it is a part, an episode, is, as I told you, a display of the whole character of mankind. It reveals an entire culture, not only of the Indian nation, but of all nationalities in their various stages of evolution. And you will be surprised, and many have been surprised, that the divine message, which should be regarded as spiritual in its character, has been imparted at a very critical moment when a war was about to take place in a battlefield. When people were up in arms to fly at the throats of each other, when there was heat in the minds of all that were arrayed in the field, you know what is battle. And an hour before, a few minutes before this terrific occasion, should be regarded as the time for giving such a message of eternity. It was not taught in a school or a college. You would have expected such a masterly teaching to be conveyed to students in a church or a temple, in an academy, in a university, in a college, in a hermitage, in a monastery, that would have been the proper time to give this message. Spirituality has little to do with war, with battle, with fighting, with bloodshed. One cannot imagine the relevance of this wondrous eternity of message to this awful scene of the battle of the Mahabharata. But here again is the speciality of the Bhagavad Gita. Therefore, I told you, it should not be regarded as merely a religious scripture. You do not expect a religious gospel to be broadcast in a battlefield. You assume an air of holiness, a sanctimonious attitude when you speak of God or religion. By holiness, you mean something which is different from unholy atmospheres. And what can be more unholy than a battle or a war? Something detestable and unthinkable and undesirable to the utmost extent is battle and war and killing each other. This is the occasion. And perhaps no other scripture can be considered to have been given in an occasion of this time. This has been an enigma to many people, and many have tried to solve the mystery behind this peculiarity of the context of the Bhagavad Gita. And peculiarities, no doubt, because the circumstance in which you are living in this world is also peculiar. The problems of life are not merely religious problems, and therefore we should not be under the impression that we can be happy merely by a so-called religious message. If by religion you understand what is in your mind usually, we know very well what we understand by religion. A holy scripture which has to be carried on head and worshipped with tremendous piety and fear in an atmosphere which has to be uncontaminated by secularity of any kind, cut off from the atmosphere of the give-and-take attitude of people, the shops and the streets and the thoroughfares. We have our own notion of religion. And religions, there have been many and there are many, and we are practicing them and we are grief-stricken yet. We are very sorry people indeed with all our religions. We are weeping every day, either openly or secretly. And the religion that we have been hugging as our dear child many a time appears as not a consolation to us. We run to other sources of protection and consolation when we are in need of support, and we do not run to religion under every circumstance. We have difficulties of various types, which are not necessarily those which can be solved by the religion that is in our heads today. And this does not require an expatiation further. We run about in 10 directions every day for solution of our problems. And we do not always go to a church or a temple if we have some difficulties. This means that your life is something which is not capable of being confined to the religion of the church or the religion of the temple. And we have not been satisfied with the God that we worship, with the religion that we practice, the scripture that we read, and the message that we have received. We are always unhappy for some reason or the other. And man has been always unhappy, and he is unhappy today, and we do not know how long he will continue to be unhappy. Is there a solution for this unhappiness of people? Is it possible for us to be really happy and be satisfied, convinced that we shall be happy and there shall be no occasion for unhappiness? If this is a possibility, then it is worthwhile investigating. And the Bhagavad Gita takes up this theme of tackling the problems of life in general and not any side of your nature. You know very well, every one of you, that your devotions and your religious practices do not cover the whole of your life. Everyone knows this very well. We have a piety inside our rooms and a different religion altogether when we walk on the road or purchase a packet of biscuit in the shop, run in the bus or travel in the train, etc., etc. And these activities and associations of ours make us turn upside down immediately. And if our confrontation of life in these various aspects in which we are unwittingly and necessarily involved can be charged with the spirit of our religion, we can be said to be truly religious. And that God will help us everywhere. And we need not run to another temporal God for solutions of our temporal problems. All temporality is a manifestation of eternity. And therefore, that which is eternal should be capable of interpreting temporal situations also. And the Bhagavad Gita, as an eternal message, is supposed to be a protection to us, even in our temporal dealings and workaday life. It is all things put together, like a mother to you. Your relationship to your mother is not merely religious. It is everything. You run to your father or a mother as a son or a daughter whenever you have any need, whatever be that need. Need not necessarily be a spiritual or so-called religious need. And the Bhagavad Gita has been regarded by people as a father or a mother in this sense. You can run to it for a cup of tea, a spoon of sugar, and you will see, I am not making a joke with you, the Gita has specifically pinpointed even these little things to make us relieved of all our tensions in all the layers of our being. And the Bhagavad Gita caters not merely to our outer personality, but that essentiality of personality in us which is related to all things in the world and the whole creation in its completeness. We are not citizens merely of Rishikesh or Uttar Pradesh or India or even this earth. We have a passport with us for entry into the various planes of existence. We are citizens of the creation of God, and merely this earth is not our habitat. Hence we have a duty which far surpasses our temporal obligations and tentative demands as nationals of a particular country or units in a particular community, etc. We have an obligation transcending the limits and the boundaries of the nations, of the societies in which we are born. And when you fulfill the requirements